given the current state of the chemist industry and anxieties like job security and worker conditions plaguing developers, there needs to be alternative ways to run indie and mid-sized studios. Worker cooperatives could be the solution. Developers from several studios spoke about the benefits and drawbacks of worker cooperatives, what they are, and how fellow developers can go and confidentially form their own. Scott Benson, developer Night in the Woods, and co-owner of the worker co-op The Glory Society, opened by outlining the positives of an egalitarian game studio. There's not some one way over your head that's sucking up the surplus value of your labor after you get paid. Benson begins. In worker cooperatives, everyone is sharing in that and discussing how that's distributed. Unlike a traditional AAA studio hierarchy, a worker co-op is business-owned, operated, and controlled democratically by its workers who share in the profits of their labor. Some are more structured when it comes to organization. It boils down to one person, one vote. It's a democratic sort of setup. Bethany Hockenberry, fellow developer on Night in the Woods, and co-owner of the Glory Society champion, sharing the history of worker co-ops. Cooperative societies have existed for centuries in various forms. Worker cooperatives rose to prominence during the Industrial Revolution, in response to growing mass production and the emergence of industrial capitalism. She shared, they have often sprung up in greater numbers during economic and labor crises. We are in the midst of a new wave of worker cooperatives being founded. There's more unionization happening, because we are in a difficult time. She added, most studios operate under a top-down structure, which includes a boss, including more higher-ups, shareholders, etc., and these workers below. Your company could be really cool. However, at the end of the day your boss has power. You do not have much of a say, usually, in how much you work or are paid. Benson added, as opposed to a worker co-op, there are not bosses, but everyone is a boss. Tasks are getting assigned and completed by fellow workers, as opposed to a boss. It changes the dynamic of how you work together. So why go co-op? There's shared control and ownership of your workplace, and the products of your labor. You can, as a group of people, go, we made this. We all share in this success. Benson said, there's greater accountability and participation. You have to talk about stuff. You have to get together and talk and vote. There's a more equal share of profits and increased quality of work, and a greater sense of community and emotional support. People are more invested, because they feel a sense of ownership. Because you are getting together and sharing the ups and downs of the responsibilities. Developers Ted Anderson, Pixel Pushes Union 512, Steve Philby, Motion Twin, and Dean Thomas, Tailspinners, all provided their personal experiences with worker co-ops, highlighting its benefits. It's a better way to develop. Everyone has a voice, and there's fair distribution of profits. Fellow devs interested in forming their own worker co-ops can click here to learn more about the process. Be sure to check out all of the resources. It's all incredibly helpful. Renowned programmer Steve Beck, who worked on titles including Story, GoDrainer, and The Spitting Image, has passed away. Beck rose to prominence during the 80s after accomplishing breakthrough feels on the Atari Street, the most notable of which came when he proved smooth scrolling was possible on the console with the creation of vertical shooter GoDrainer. He also teamed up with Chris Sorrow to create James Bond for Millennium, which went on to spawn a successful franchise. Beck had been living with diabetes in recent years, and his son Philip broke news of his passing on Twitter alongside a touching obituary. So this morning that diet, he was at home and it was very fast. His diabetes had been a lot worse these last years. We became estranged in mid-90s. Become more amicable years later. And the last time I saw him was my wedding day in 2005. Here quote, the golden memories were from the 80s. The times we spent playing and making video games. I can still smell the little clear plastic bags full of 10 pence pieces with due empty in two arcade machines. He gave me my love of programming and would always let me get involved in whatever he was working or playing on. And whilst watching him being asked at computer shows for an autograph, never stopped feeling silly. I was ever so proud. I hope he knew that. See you on the other side, Dad. When I ran out of coins, I am sure I will find you by the celestial Mr. Do Machine. Disney CEO Bob Iger outlines the company's gaming development plans. Disney is not handing the development or publishing of games based on its vast and growing library of franchises. But the company is perfectly content working with external companies like Electronic Arts instead. Disney CEO Bob Iger briefly discussed how the company's approach to games has changed over the last several years in a recent earnings call, and noted that the company has good relationships with the developers working on licensed works, including Battlefront 2 Devi, over the years. As you know, we have tried our hand at self-publishing. We have bought companies. We have sold companies. We have bought developers. We have closed developers, Iger said in comments, grabbed by Variety. And we have found, over the years, that we have not been particularly good at the self-publishing side, but we have been great at the licensing side, which obviously does not require that much allocation of capital. Some of those closures Iger mentions include the 2016 closure of Disney Infinity developer Avalanche Studios, resulting in 300 layoffs, and the more recent shutdown of the game club Penguin Island, which reportedly caused dozens of layoffs at developer Disney Canada. Disney's current solution, outside of more casual mobile games, is licensing its properties to external developers, something Iger says is a much better fit for the company. The most memorable of those licensing agreements is Disney's ongoing partnership with Disney that, though rocked by some loot box controversy last year, is still aligned and well according to Disney. Since we are allocating capital in other directions, we have just decided that the best place for us to be in that space is licensing and not publishing, said Iger. We have had good relationships with some of those we are licensing to, notably and the relationship on the Star Wars properties, and we are probably going to stay on that side of the business and put our capital elsewhere. Cities, Skylines, Stellaris, and Surviving Mars developer Paradox Interactive has put Cassette Prison, architect from Introversion Software, for an undisclosed fee. Paradox will specifically acquire all the rights and assets to the Prison building and management scene, which has sold over 2 million copies across PC and consoles, and will take ownership of the franchise on all current and future platforms. In short, that means Paradox will be able to steer the direction and development of the series moving forward, and the company is keen to explore opportunities with the wider architect property in the future. Introversion co-founder Mark Morris said the team ultimately chose to let another studio have a crack at the franchise after taking it as far as it could over the past decade. Prison Architect thus be an intensely rewarding project for us, commented Morris. Every developer loves seeing their creations come to life. But through early access, launch on multiple platforms, and over a dozen post-launch content updates. We have been building and managing this building and management game for nearly a decade. I think we have taken Prison Architect just about as far as we can, and we are all eager to see where a team like Paradox can take it next. This also gives Introversion the chance to work on what we have got coming up next. 11-bit Studios Survival Strategy Games Frostpunk and This Wha of Mine are both standout examples of games that push players to make hard choices. And the attendees of the 2019 Game Developers Conference in March will get an inside look at how they came together. Together, 11-bit Studios creative director Michael Drzeski on art, DIRECTORPERZMYSLAW Marshall, will be presenting a design chart or call about Why Make Games, Lessons from Frostpunk, and This War of Mine. The pair will discuss specific approaches to the creative process, and the concepts utilized during the process. They will also show you how to cultivate a specific work culture within a team, and how art and design processes are driven to make games like Ethos, War of Men and Frostpunk. Finally, you should walk away with greater insight into how games are maturing into an influential medium.